I hope there's someone in your life that you can say, I love them, and certainly the most important of all is that you would love the Lord. Really, you know, we try to complicate things as preachers and theologians, and it's not complicated at all. Just fall in love with Jesus. Over and over and over again. Just fall in love with Jesus. We have a great song that says, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. The things of earth grow strangely dim. In the light of his glory and grace, just fall in love with Jesus. You'd be surprised how many things in life just straighten out perfectly when you just love the Lord your God. Fall in love with Jesus. It is, after all, the command of our Lord. Matthew 22, we talk about this quite often, so I won't stay here very long, but it is commanded. You should love the Lord your God. No, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. The question was asked of the lawyer, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with... You know, you guys could be preachers if you'd say it a little louder. This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. When we think about the subject of love, and we always try to match our music with the theme of the morning sermon, and when we think about love and all the songs we do about love, most of those, the vast majority of the songs that we have in our repertoire here are God loves us. And that is an objective way to worship, and it is important that you would know the love of God greater far than tongue or pen could ever tell. But there also is something that must be reciprocated. He loves us. In fact, the Bible says that God loved us while we were yet sinners. God commended his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So there is no doubt about the love of God. But now, what do we do in response to his love? We love him because he first loved us, right? And so we offer our love to the Lord. And so I would encourage you to love the Lord your God. It is the command of Scripture. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all thy mind. Who do you love? Simon Peter has failed the Lord miserably. You don't need to raise your hand here. Please don't. But how many of you have ever failed the Lord miserably? You know. Oh, if I could go back and change. But his grace, for a wretch, for a worm, as I, his grace still amazes me. Wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all our sins. Grace that is greater than all our sins. Simon Peter's failed the Lord, he's denied him three times. Now Jesus is warning him about it at the Lord's Supper. These may fail me, Lord, but I'll never fail you. But sure enough, before the rooster crowed three times, Simon Peter had denied the Lord. How horrible he felt, how isolated, how alone he must have felt. I go fishing, and I won't tell you what clothes he had on because he didn't have any. Pretty messed up guy. You know, sin will mess you up. Conscience will bother you, and the Spirit of God, of course, convicts us. And, of course, there Jesus feeds the disciples, and bread and fish upon the fire come and dine. And then he questions Simon Peter, John 21:15. Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? Well, talk about pinpointing the heart of the matter. Now, I have to admit, and maybe it's different in your household, I hope it is, but I have to admit, when my wife tells me she loves me, and I will quickly respond, I love you too. I mean, I don't hesitate on that. She says, I love you, and I say, I love you too. It's kind of like asking if this dress makes me look fat. No, it doesn't. Before they ever get the last word out, I say, no, it does not. It does not. It's great. Well, I love you too. And then occasionally she'll say, well, why don't you say it first? Because I'm dense. Stupid, actually. Just say it first, right? Talk to you about this subject another time. You're not interested. But anyway. Don't you think the Lord, who loves us so much, would love to hear from his bride, his church, of our love, our thanks, our appreciation for who he is, for all he's done for us, that we love him, and then we find ourselves as Simon Peter, as a failure, pinpointed, asked the question, do you love me? It was another occasion that Simon Peter was asked, and all the disciples were, who do men say that I am, and then who do you say that I am? And he had the right answer, prior to Christ, the Son of the living God. But you know, when you fail the Lord as miserably as Simon Peter had at this point, when you fail the Lord in such a fashion, somebody turn the power off that green box, please. Michelle, could you get that green box and power off for us? I don't know if it's a semi-truck messing with us or a ham radio, but it sure is messing with us. Nonetheless, or maybe the devil's from that. When you have failed the Lord as miserably as Simon Peter had, mostly said, I'll never fail you. They will, but I won't. And then Jesus pinpoints the question, lovest thou me more than these? Well, Lord, you know I love you. Feed my sheep. How many times did Simon Peter fail the Lord that night? 3 times. How many times will Jesus ask you the question? 3 times. Lovest thou me more than these? Lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said to him now yet a third time, lovest thou me? Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. He goes on and talks in prophecy about Simon Peter's death and martyrdom that Simon Peter will face. And then in verse 19, signifying what death he should glorify God, when he had spoken this, he said unto his wife, follow me. Hey, church, this is really simple stuff. Love him and follow him. Isn't that simple? That's what guys like me can get. Love him and follow him. Well, Peter turns about and sees the disciple whom Jesus loved, John. John, which leaned on Jesus' breast at the supper. Lord, which is he that, and the one said, Lord, which is he that betrayed thee? Peter, seeing him, said to Jesus, Lord, and what shall this man do? Isn't that interesting? When we're getting the pinpoint examination of the Lord, we're always trying to find somebody else to cast the light on. Jesus has told him, feed my sheep, follow me. And Simon Peter wants to cast it off and looks at John and said, and what about this guy? What about this man? What will he do? Jesus saith unto him, if I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. I don't know when I studied this, I don't know what caught me so much about this, but it really did. Because so many times I'm distracted.
Speaking a little bit.
by what others are doing.
Do you think it's okay now?
And with great conviction, that I feel that, hey Dan, what is that to you? Follow me. I don't know how the Lord speaks to you. Maybe He'll tell you'll be richer than rich and have a worldwide ministry and thousands of people will know your name and you'll be. That isn't how the Lord speaks to me. When the Lord speaks to me, it's generally shape up. Shape up. And I can well imagine how Simon Peter must have felt as he's trying to cast the light off of himself and onto John. And Jesus has nothing to do with it and says, what is that to you? You follow me. You know, every one of us have the responsibility to the Lord to follow Him, to love Him. And it doesn't matter what the other person's doing. It matters, what am I doing? What are you doing? It's called individual responsibility. Right? Individual responsibility. I wish that I could go to heaven on the good graces of my grandmother and my great-grandmother and my mother. But I know that they won't be standing there when I stand before the judge. Right? An individual responsibility. Do you love the Lord? Are you following the Lord? And it doesn't matter what happens to Him. You follow me. Follow me. Number three. When we talk about loving the Lord, the Bible gives us several prophecies, and this is the main thing that I wanted to cover today. What about our love for the Lord? Is it enduring, or is it like the others that are about us? The Bible will say later of the church at Ephesus that they had left their first love. I don't want to be that way. How about you? I want to love the Lord more today than yesterday. More tomorrow than today, and may it go that way until He comes. And so, prophecy is given by our Lord Jesus and says that many false prophets shall rise and deceive many. I'm telling you, friends, there is a great deception out there. I said there's a great deception out there. How men and women in pulpits can read the Bible and stand up in those pulpits and say just the opposite of what the Scripture says and call it God's Word or even call it grace is beyond me. Preaching to those who desire and have itching ears. Many false prophets shall rise and deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound. How's iniquity doing out there? You know, if they had something to sell on the stock market called iniquity, you might want to put your money on it because it's increasing. It's on the rise. Iniquity shall abound. The love of many shall wax cold. You want to talk about backsliding? This prophecy speaks about backsliding. The love of many indicates they had love, but now they don't have love. It has waxed cold. And then he goes on to say, but he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. I grew up with this stuff. It may not be as much to some of you as it does to me. But I'm telling you, friends, I'm going through. I'll pay the price, whatever I must do. I'll take away with the Lord's despised few. I'm going through Jesus. I'm going through. Then somebody rewrote the song. I'll pay the Lord's anointed few. No, the original song was I'll take away with the Lord's despised few. How many of you want to enjoy the despised few? You want to keep on holding on. No turning back, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. Come on, friends, he that endures to the end shall be saved. Furthermore, Jesus had told him earlier, no man having put his hand to the plow and turning back is fit for the kingdom of God. This year our theme has been Rejoice and Overcome the World. One of the great ways that you can rejoice and overcome the world is to have a love that is not decreasing, but a love for the Lord that is increasing. Oh, I love you more, Lord, today than yesterday. And our prayer should be, Lord, help me to love you more tomorrow than I did today. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. Well, these many, they may concern you. Many false prophets, many deceived, many that are filled with iniquity. The love of many waxes cold, but he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. Are you interested in that last word? That word takes care of all the other stuff. If I'm saved, and I know that I am, takes care of what all the others are doing. Oh, it's bad, it's bad, it's bad. Pastor, what's going to happen? Well, it's going to get worse. I know you came to be edified today. I'm just telling you, it's going to get worse. Come on, man, you know what it is. But the reality is, that doesn't matter if you're one that endures to the end. It doesn't matter what they're going to do or what they're going to do. It matters what are you going to do. Don't let your love for the Lord wax cold. That's how you overcome the world. Number four, they receive not the love of the truth. How many of you love God's word?
Yes.
Hallelujah. I'm going to read quite a section here. 2 Thessalonians 2:8. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. What do you think about the fate of the wicked one? Doesn't look too good for him. He's going to be consumed with the spirit of the mouth of the Lord. He's going to be destroyed with the brightness of the Lord's coming. Wow. I like that. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. You know, 36 years of this, I've noticed that the church always wants to know more about the Antichrist. Who is he? Is he this guy? Is he that guy? Is he another guy? I remember when Gorbachev came on the scene and he had that birthmark on his head. And if you had asked me that day if Gorbachev was the Antichrist, I'd say, no! And on and on it goes. Seems like every time we get a new president, is he the Antichrist? No. Everybody's interested in the Antichrist. I recommend to you, if you want to be an overcomer, to focus on the Christ.
Yeah.
Not the Antichrist. There's only one that you need to really focus on. See, when you know the true, you don't need to worry about all the false. In fact, many Antichrists are already in the world in John's day, let alone in our day, so why worry about it? They come with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. The perishing are deceived, brethren. Because they receive what? They receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. Hallelujah. Tell me about that truth thing. Thy word is, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth. See, you know a lot about the truth, don't you? And if you love the truth, you're going to be saved. I have a lot of things I can't do, but I can love the truth. Thy word is truth. You're looking for another source of truth, you will not find it. It is the word of God. Love the truth and be saved. Now these who don't, God shall send them strong delusion. Now, we're talking about the things that are happening in last times and end of days. And God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. If you're wondering here, if we are in the last days, why things are getting worse and the love of many is waxing worse and all of these things are happening, I might want to tell you that it's not the devil that's doing all of this. God is giving them over to their own way of thinking. God is giving them over to their own perversion. God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie. What a contrast there is between those who love the truth and who are going to be saved and those who believe the lie. God shall send them strong delusion and they'll believe the lie. That all might be damned who believe not the truth but have pleasure in unrighteousness. I'd like you to look at the last word in verse 10. What is it? Saved. Saved. Hallelujah. Everybody got that? Saved. E-D. Saved. And then, of course, in verse 12, those that might be damned. Let me give you a little clue what's going on in the world today. If you sit under preaching, a pastor or a church that never speaks on both sides of this coin, you better find a new church and a new preacher. Because yes, there is the love of God, the goodness of God, the grace of God that causes us to be saved. But there is also a damnation. I say it all the time, a heaven to gain, a hell to shun. So what would we rather hear? More positive things. I'm positive about it. There's a heaven to gain. And hell to shun. And those that don't believe this truth, they're damned. And they have pleasure in unrighteousness. Number 5. This is actually 2 points, but you know me, I like 7, so. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. Now there's quite a list here, and I'm not going to spend time on this, just 2 points. Men shall be lovers of their own selves. We were instructed in the very first point of this message, Matthew 22, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love thy neighbor as thyself. And what is the contrast of that? These in the evil days, they will be lovers of their own selves. They don't think about anybody else. They don't care about anybody else. It's all about me, 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 me. Just tell your neighbor, it's not all about you. My, what Jesus could have done on earth if it had just been about him. He came to seek and save that which was lost, came to minister, not to be ministered to, came to die, give his life a ransom for many. You see, for Jesus, it was all about the world. That the world through him might be saved. For Jesus, it was all about lost humanity. Then we see folks today, they could care less about anybody else. Me, me, me. I. What I want. Now, I'm an only child and of my mother and dad's marriage. And so when it came time to have the will, my mother's will, taken care of, me, myself, and I had a fight. I mean, we really got into it. Me wanted this, and myself wanted that, and we were just all, me prevailed and got it all. They're everywhere, aren't they? Me, me, me. I. I don't care how it affects anybody else. care what it does in my... You know the grossest part of it all? I see what it does to their children. My, my, my. Men shall be lovers of their own selves. And then finally, as he goes through this list of things that are prophetic in nature, he says in verse 4, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. That had a good ring to it. Lovers, you know, it really did. It had a good ring to it. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Now, I've got about a million choices right now to illustrate this. But you're probably going to have to decide between Hollywood and Holy Word. Go ahead, go away. Seriously, you're going to have to decide between Hollywood and Holy Word because they are nothing similar. Preacher, I can't make church tonight. I got a movie I want to go see. Pastor, I can't make church tonight. There's a show on TV that I'm invested in. Are you kidding? Pastor, I can't make church tonight. We're going down to the boats. I've never heard that one before, but don't start. People have in our day that they are lovers of their own selves and they love pleasures more than they love God. How about us? Number 6. Paul speaks of Demas in 2 Timothy 4 and 10. For Demas hath forsaken me. Have you ever had a friend that abandoned you? That's a tough thing to take, isn't it? I experienced that once in my life, and I would have never thought it could happen. And it was just, well, it was so hurtful, so painful to have a friend that you count on and believe in, and lifelong friend, and then done with you. I well imagine how Paul, who had been in prison, beaten, stoned, left for dead, had the marks of persecution on his body, must have felt, as he told Timothy,